Last week we started to look at Luke chapter 15, and we had just finished a look at the introduction of the chapter, the first three verses, and how it sets the stage for the three great parables, the most famous of which is the parable of the prodigal son, and how the stage was set with those opening verses showing the three attitudes that were on display, and those who were seeking isolation from sinners, that's the Pharisees, those who were seeking solution for their sin, that's the publicans, and sinners, and those offering reconciliation both together through Christ to God. And so in order to convey that message, Jesus teaches three parables. Now, in this middle of three lessons, let's take our time now to just kind of overview the three parables and see the great overall message that is delivered. And then next week we'll examine the parable of the prodigal son in particular. But it starts in verse 4 with the first of the three parables, where Jesus says, "What man of you, having 100 sheep and lose one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost." Now, there's a second parable that starts in verse 7, but immediately we learn something about God's attitude toward a fallen away child of his who is restored to him, and that is joy. God has joy, and Jesus describes the scene as one sheep that is lost out of 100. 99 are safe, 99 are secure, but one that is lost, and how the shepherd will go and seek after that one. And even though he is greatly outnumbered, he is important to God, and so God will go seeking him out. And when he finds him, when they are reconciled, there is joy, he says, in the home of God. He calls all of his friends together, "Come to my home and let us celebrate." Joy in the home of God. Second parable, verse 7. "I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repents, more than over 99 just persons that need no repentance." Sorry, obviously that connects to the previous parable. Now, verse 8, the next parable. "Either..." Also, second parable, "What woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she loses one piece, does not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently till she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and her neighbors together, saying, Rejoice with me, for I have found the piece which I had lost. Likewise, I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repents." And so we have once again this attitude of joy. He rejoices. This woman who loses a coin, just one coin out of all the coins in her purse, but one is important to her, not because she's selfish or stingy, but because she wants to have her entire collection. One is lost, so she seeks the one. She lights a candle, she searches her entire house, top to bottom, every nook and cranny, under every piece of furniture, until finally she finds her one lost coin. And there is such celebration in the attitude of this person, this woman who's lost her coin and now reclaimed it. It was taken away from her and now is restored to her. And so what does she do? Verse 9, she calls all her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me. Let us all be happy together." And God says to that, verse 10, "There is joy likewise in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repents." Incidentally, listen to Jesus' words carefully. There is joy where? In the presence of the angels. Are the angels rejoicing? Absolutely. But there is joy in the presence, in the midst of, surrounding the angels. Who is in the midst of the angels? The angels are in whose presence? The presence of God the Father. There's joy among the host of God that is echoed by the joy of God himself over one lost coin, one possession, if you will, that comes back to God's purse. So that's the second parable. The third one, of course, is verses 11 through 32. We'll consider this parable in detail next week. But I want to notice the ending of it, and that is particularly verse 32, the last verse of the parable of the prodigal son. And let's see the overall lesson to learn from it. The father says to the elder brother, who was angry his younger had come home, he says, "It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found." The language by the father is emphatic. Literally, your brother was dead and dead forever. He was dead and buried and gone, and now he's alive again. In other words, the impossible has happened. He was lost and gone forever, And then he says, and is found. In other words, the impossible has happened. And you can read it as we'll go through it in detail next week. And you can just see the great joy in the very heart of this father. In the, therefore, heart of God himself over one child who comes home. There's joy in the home of God. There's joy in the host of God. There's joy in the heart of God. It was meet. It was necessary, he says. It was a good thing that we would make merry, that we would celebrate, that we would be happy, because that which should not be possible has happened. A sinner has been saved. Jesus makes the impossible happen. I should not have any relationship with God anymore. After my first sin, the holy face of God turns away from me, spiritually speaking. My fellowship with him is therefore impossible. It cannot be undone by me. I made the mistake, I fell in the hole, and I cannot dig my way out of it. But Jesus threw me the rope. Jesus pulled me up. Jesus made the impossible possible. I was dead and gone forever, and yet I'm alive again. I was lost and lost forever, and yet through Jesus I am found again. And so there's joy when that happens in the heart of a father, in the heart of God, over his son that comes home. We'll consider this parable in more detail next week as we look at why this is a great chapter. And it should already be taking focus. It should already be coming clear why this is one of the great chapters of the Bible. But we'll pick up with Luke chapter 15 once more next week. Until then, thank you very much.